Beautiful Girls at Canada Games, written by Daniel J. Tozzi, the visionary folk photographer Donnie L. Tozzi. Photoshop.com, March 5th, 2011. Unfortunately, I have to write this true story to clear my name and reputation. Soon you will understand why I picked the title and why I was attacked by some evil ugly people here in Halifax and Dartmouth for saying those words. Some of you might be aware that I was deliberately run over by a car multiple times on November 22, 2009, leaving me seriously and permanently physically damaged, so that the only way I can go out now is in my electric wheelchair. You may read this, but I warn you, it is very articulate, graphic truth. How to assassinate a cyclist. I would like you to understand that I have been attending maritime physiotherapy now twice a week since just after being run over by the car 40 months ago. This physiotherapy is very important to try to keep my muscles from dying off, as I can no longer do much of anything. I have been able to do a bit of walking around the padded Sportsplex running track. This is equivalent to me walking about 30 minutes a month. Please know that there is no other place for me to walk safely, and that it is winter here now and I cannot walk outside until spring. Hopefully I will not have deteriorated so much that I will not be able to go for short, slow walks with my four-wheel walker in the spring. I have also been doing physio for my right shoulder and arm that now has a plastic prosthesis in it. This is also very important so that what few functioning muscles I have in my right shoulder and upper arm do not completely die off. I have been undergoing fittings for two knee braces, a shoulder brace, an abdomen brace, and special cushioned shoes. I have many more health complications that I cannot write now. I have told you this because now the authorities are banning me from receiving this necessary medical aid. And so far I have also been unable to get professional medical aid for numerous other very serious complications due to being run over by the car while I was riding my bicycle. I have not been seen by an orthopedic surgeon for my broken back and two neck spinal injuries. I am also having serious complications with my right shoulder prosthesis that needs medical attention, and again I have not been able to get any medical attention. Dear reader, please understand that here in Nova Scotia, Canada, every person is given full free medical care, so why have I been denied this? Below you will read how they used my photographing the Canada Games to get me permanently banned from getting the physiotherapy I need. Some of you may also realize that now there is only one thing left that I can do that gives me pleasure and a chance to have contact with people and to socialize, that being my love of photography. Please have a look at sites such as this at donnieltozzi.photoshop.com. Sadly, I will never again be able to walk in the wilderness. Visiting or making friends is now nearly impossible because their homes or most properties are not accessible for wheelchairs. I was run over for being an activist. You can read why at donnieltozzi.wordpress.com. An activist is one that always seeks the truth and speaks the truth, for truth is an action. I choose to always live by pure truth, for without truth there can never be any love of anything. I will now read this article. I am in love and I am so happy by a truth soldier. I did it. I found my soulmate. It's amazing, my soulmate is so beautiful and perfect. I can count on my soulmate to never deceive me or send me in the wrong direction. My soulmate is always there for me. We always get along because we are in pure love. Our love works because it's based on truth. For without truth our relationship would be doomed. We are never selfish, for we always give of ourselves. In troubled times I confide with my soulmate for support. I tell my soulmate my deepest secrets and weaknesses. I don't fear exposing my innermost frailties to my soulmate. It's so amazing what strength can be gained from sharing pure love. Love makes me feel so good that I now can see beauty all around me. I see it in the flowers and the bees. I see it all around me in nature. I see beauty even in the worst of storms. I see it in other people who are in love. Before I fell in love with my soulmate, I walked around and could never see the beauty all around me. I am in love and I am so happy. This pure love is so strong that I now have enough love to give even to the sorriest of souls. Love is so contagious. Once I got pure love in my life, I was strengthened so that I could now share some of it with those around me who have never felt pure love before. This pure love in my life has humbled me so. I could have never found my soulmate if I had not always sought truth and always spoke the truth I discovered. I have been completed as a human with this pure love. I love truth, for without it I would always be lost and deceived. The more my love grows, the more beautiful my soulmate becomes, for love is in the eye of the beholder. I know that my soulmate will always forgive me if I am always willing to face and admit the truth of my wrongdoings. My soulmate will always know if I am not being truthful to myself. There can never be a pure love in my heart if I am not always truthful to myself. For my soulmate's pure love could never reach me if I am not pure in truth. I am in love and I am so happy. I love you, God, for you are the truth and my soulmate. The end. I believe in democracy and living in an open and free society. This cannot be without our society being structured on the principles of truth, justice, and liberty. So with this love, I then discovered all naturally beautiful things, whether it be going through heaven's gate, listening to the buzzing of the bees on a wildflower, a little red fox coming out of the cold dark forest, the sun on a rock in the dawning of another beautiful day, the Son of God lighting my path, the grasshopper posing, or just walking on water. Through my photography, I developed an amazing passion for all that is naturally beautiful in life. I have then spent the rest of my life going out and seeking beauty to capture with my camera so that I could share it with others, hoping that they could also behold and appreciate pure natural beauty. I then uploaded and freely shared this beauty with the world on the World Wide Web. I have often been judged, ridiculed, questioned as to why would I give my beautiful images away for free, and all the work that doing all those photos series meant. I could only answer people with this answer: all the beauty I have captured with my camera is the work of God. I could never charge anyone for my beautiful images. I could only hope and pray that people could learn to appreciate the natural beauty in this world as I have, and that in doing this they would then try to protect that natural beauty. Then I would express how much pleasure going out to festivals, seeking a wildflower or a butterfly to photograph, has given me. My pursuit for beauty through the eye of a photographer has given me such richness of life that nothing can justly express this. Which is why I wrote this in hopes to share this with young people and families. I have observed that all that is naturally beautiful is under serious threat of complete destruction by the sick people of this world who have never known the inner peace that can only come from being in tune with the undamaged, naturally pure world, because that world is getting so impossible to find. I have created a library of images that captured pure natural beauty, be it plant, creature, environment, or even human nature, that has been undamaged by evil, selfish, psychologically unnatural, unhealthy people. www.webshots.com/user/tozy. I saw the best of human nature in the young athletes of the Canada Games. I found their enthusiasm a refreshing sight compared to the artificial, corrupt corporate world we now see all around us. But I find that most people are selfish and have no desire to love, appreciate, or protect natural beauty. As I sat there in my wheelchair on the cushion running track up high above the rows of seats in the Dartmouth Sportsplex, I looked down onto the ice rink as the machine was cleaning the ice. It was between periods of the girls' hockey game. There was this old man sitting at the top row and end aisle seat just beside me. We spoke about things and about our experiences in life, I described my passion and discovery of the wonders and beauty of wilderness. I spoke with him about my first discovering wilderness at age 16 when I went on my portage into the wilderness. Note, you can read my article entitled Portage into the Wilderness. I escaped the huge city with millions of people living in the artificial polluted concrete jungle. For the first time in my life I was free. I turned 16 and escaped the structured corrupt corporate world. He told me he was now retired and had more time to do all the things he enjoyed in life, like hunting wildlife. He tried to express his pleasure and love of wilderness in comparison to my love of wilderness. He did not come close to the pure love I have for living. So I had to leave by implying to him that in my hikes into the wilderness I truly enjoyed the hunt, but that I, unlike him, hunted with my Canon camera and I let the wild animals go on their way unharmed. Now there are so few, if any, and especially large wild animals left in the forest. Now also even the pure undamaged natural forests are mostly gone. I have only been able to find this concrete moose representation of this majestic creature that once freely roamed in all the natural forests that used to be here in Nova Scotia. Now all that remains is that old man sitting there retired and speaking of all the wildlife that he and countless others like him have effectively permanently eliminated from the face of the natural world. Whereas he told me that he respected wildlife by only shooting the best creatures so he could have a trophy. That truly made me feel sick and disgusted. I told him that I was here doing a photo series of the Canada Games. I believe that he and his wife were the ones that tried to destroy me, because that man did not like my comment about me hunting with my camera, nor did he like my youthful lively enthusiasm for life. Below you will read the horrible things that were done to me and my reputation at the Dartmouth Sportplex. My love for truth has made me a beautiful and sincerely honest loving person, and for that, those around me that do not have the purity I have achieved cannot understand nor acknowledge my natural beautiful human nature. They only seek to destroy anything they do not understand and do not believe to be possible. They do not believe that some people like me can be so inwardly beautiful and possess such complete honesty. The inwardly ugly people only show and exhibit hate for the hate that the spirit of a beautiful person forces them to have to look into themselves. Whereas, then they would have to be truthful for the first time in their lives and accept that they are not so inwardly nice. Haters only hide truth and nothing else. Haters are so destructive. So instead of doing the work to improve themselves as human beings, they do the easy thing, and that is to destroy the natural beauty in this world. Be it by stepping on a grasshopper, plucking that flower out of the ground, killing the majestic moose, killing the little fox by placing a snare by its sunning rock, cutting down the forest of Heaven's Gate, or they would rather spray chemtrails in our skies to hide the Son of God. So as an example of how people today do not know what is natural, people cannot even see what is so serious and very real. People do not even observe the sky itself. They completely refuse to explore and understand what chemtrails are. If they did, they would understand how real this danger is. Please read my The Sky Is Not Blue Chemtrails article. So this brings me to showing you again how those who seek and speak no truth know nothing about natural beauty, nor do they even know the meaning of the word. These evil people, being so superficial, can only think that beauty is on the outside. So when I was there at the Sportplex in Dartmouth, Nova Scotia on February 22, 2011, I had spent many of the previous days caught up in the wonderful spirit and enthusiasm of the Canada Games and absolutely enjoyed doing my photos series of the best young athletes of Canada. I was so impressed by the Canada Games and often said to people that they should be proud to be Canadian. I said that I especially enjoyed watching pure sport that had no violence in it. where the athlete could do their best without fearing that trophy-hunting attitude where someone would come along and attack them by driving them into the boards. Violence was not allowed at the Canada Games. The rule was that you would be thrown out of the team if you did any violence while playing the sporting game. So why is it that I was attacked by the authorities at the Canada Games for taking pictures of this beautiful event? So I ended my conversation with the gun hunter. There was still another 15 minutes before the game would be restarted, so I went outside to bum a cigarette. The Great White North was freezing and really windy, so I did not stay outside of the sportsplex for long. As I tried to enter the doors to the ice rink area, I was confronted by the Wicked Witch. This older woman with a really ugly human nature that showed through in her facial expressions blocked me from entering. She wore a Canada Games volunteer tag that seemed to give her access to everywhere. I saw her last name is Webb, and her first name was a four-letter name such as Donna. She verbally assaulted me. She never said I could not enter. She just stood in front of my electric wheelchair blocking me and spewing out verbal rudeness, and when I told her she was extremely rude, she put her open hands in front of my face. I then screamed out that she needs to take her hands out of my face. The lobby area was full of people getting ready to go watch the second period of the hockey game. Earlier, before I tried to enter, I had been having a conversation with a guy by the name of Neil Baker. He seemed to be a genuinely nice person. So after this confrontation at the entrance, I went back to Neil to ask him if he was willing to be a witness to the event unfolding. I asked him if I could get his phone number, and he gave me an odd and very suspicious answer. First, he said he did not have a phone number. Then he said, "You will have to contact me through HRM, which translates to Halifax Regional Municipality." That to me meant that he was an undercover agent for probably the police. But then I asked him if he had an email, so he said yes and gave me neilbaker@hotmail. I have not tried to contact him since I think he was not what he appeared. So it is clear to me that I was set up in a sting operation by the HRM police. Be it known that the Dartmouth Sportplex is owned and operated by HRM and all the staff there is also, which is all paid for by the tax-paying public. Also note that the Canada Games was staffed by over 6,000 unpaid volunteers who were most likely also unemployed, which was why they were able to volunteer their time. The Canada Games was fully paid for by the taxpayers of Canada, and as such was also a public event. So I ask you now, why would they charge admission, especially when you notice in my pictures that the stands were almost completely empty? Why was it that Canada Games did not offer any free games to the public in the HRM area? Why did they not offer a few of these low attendance games as being free, so the low or no income people could have also had a chance to enjoy the Canada Games? Hey, all the poor that donated their time for free as volunteers soon realized that they would not even get to watch any of the games. About my taking pictures at the Canada Games, not once was I told by anyone that I was not permitted to take pictures, which is why I was able to do the male hockey, ringettes, and female hockey games series of photos. Oh, and let's not forget the concerts and athletes in Halifax. If you truly care about truth, then you are very capable of seeing the truth. It is very easy to see my human nature. Have a look at these photos below that Constable Chambers badge number 866,615 called porno pictures, which are from my Dreamgirls Butterfly Smiles album at my donnyeltozy.photoshop.com site. Now look really closely at the expressions they are showing me. Why do you think they have such beautiful expressions? Do you not understand that they are reacting to me? Now please understand that Constable Chambers said that in a public place in front of many people, so that he insulted all the girls in these pictures and many more. Here is some more porno in case you believe everything the police says. So what do you think? Am I a pervert as the constable wanted everyone to believe? And by the way, Marie Eve is a witness to what I was doing at the Sportplex when I was doing my photography, and she, like all the other dream girls, agreed to be photographs and for me to put their pictures in my photo albums. So now, after I was blocked from entering the upper level of the Sportplex to the ice rink, I went down the elevator to the lower main level and waited by the main doors, which lead to Wise Road and is where the athletes were to board the buses. It is also where I took all the team pictures of the hockey players. Also, at this location is where the main office is for all the volunteers that were essentially running the Canada Games at the Dartmouth Sportsplex. So they were also witnesses to what I was doing. This lobby area is also covered by security cameras that record everything that goes on. I am sure there are many other cameras throughout the property, so that all my activities would have been easily verified. There's no surveillance videotapes that shows any inappropriate behavior by me. As I arrived by the main doors, a gentleman came up to me with a very mean expression on his face and said he wanted me to come with him and that he wanted to talk to me. Now please always remember that I am very disabled and I am sitting in an electric wheelchair. This man's name is Bob Quigley, Director of Facility Development. 902-464-2600 extension 312. He then said to me that he received a complaint about my taking inappropriate pictures of girls. He then said that I was asked not to take pictures of the girls. He continued with his story. So I interrupted him several times and I asked him to stop repeating these words in a public place. I said to him that everything he said was not true. I asked him if he wanted to look at the pictures in my camera. He said no and continued with his unwarranted and unproven complaint. I asked him to stop saying the things he was saying, and then I asked him to call the police because he refused to hear anything I had to say. So I then backed my chair up against the wall and in front of the surveillance camera. It took a long time before the police arrived. Two officers arrived in separate cars. Upon entering, they quickly approached me while Chambers made many tyrannical statements at me and expressed himself with the behavior of a street thug. The officer to my right, who I believe was Constable Chambers, was extremely aggressive and threatening. He quickly approached me and started reaching to grab me. The other officer actually started reaching for his holster and gave Constable Chambers a very stern look of warning, as if saying, "I am not going to allow you to touch this disabled person in a wheelchair." The good officer on my left then only asked me one question. He asked me what had happened to me and why was I in a wheelchair. I told him that I was run over by a car. The good officer has never been identified to me. So Chambers started interrogating me. He completely refused to accept anything I had to say, and it was very clear to me that he had an agenda. That agenda had nothing to do with truth or my civil rights. It would take too much time for me to write here the contents of the 2 hours of interrogation Chambers did. I will give you some points of our conversation. I asked Chambers to have a look at my pictures in my camera. He found nothing wrong or offensive. He then said that proves nothing as it is a digital camera. I then gave him one of my Divisionary Folk Photographer business cards, which has two of my main photo websites with photo albums of the many series I have done over the past 12 years. He repeatedly said I was taking inappropriate pictures of young girls. I had been asked to not take pictures. He said I did not have permission from any of the team members, their coaches or families to take their pictures. So I told Chambers that yes, I did have permission. I advised him that everyone knew who I was and what I was doing. I gave out many of my business cards to many people. I always asked the team members if I could do a team photo. I told them that I am doing a photo series of the Canada Games and their hockey game. I told them I was going to create some albums online that they could go and freely download the pictures, and that this would include action pictures of their game on the ice. Every team I met over the previous 2 weeks loved what I was doing and were very happy that someone was going to do photos of their games. They were thrilled that I was doing it all for free. Told Chambers that it was impossible for me to take team pictures, having up to 30 people posing and smiling at me, if they did not agree to me taking their pictures. Please note that most of these pictures were done at the Sportplex. Up above and to the left in many of the photos you can see the surveillance camera that I stayed in front of, which means I was over on the right side against the wall while the police were questioning me. If you were to check out the team names and look at the schedule when they were at the Sportsplex, you would soon realize that my pictures were taken over a period of 2 weeks, proving that I had no problems and was never asked not to take pictures. Especially considering I was taking pictures of their whole game while they were on the ice. The interrogation with Chamber continued. Then he said I need to have a signed agreement from the people I was photographing. I said that is not true. Anyone can take pictures in a public place and of a public event. I never asked for signature because that would mean that I was entering into a binding and for-profit business agreement. I did not want to do this, as every person I have ever photographed always gave me permission to take the pictures and to put them on my websites. By not having a signed contract, anyone that I ever took and uploaded a picture of could at any time ask me to remove their picture from my online photo albums if they did not like the picture. This has never happened, and I have never ever received a complaint from anyone. I have photographed and uploaded pictures of politicians, sports stars, singers, performers, public figures, tourists, military, naval, bands, buskers, dream girls, and on without any problems ever. Hey, here is the mayor of Halifax and two of my pictures taken at the Canada Games. So then I said to Chamber that yes, I had permission from team members and even family members to take their pictures. I randomly picked the girls' Newfoundland team as an example. So Chambers, like before, disappeared and came back saying that he spoke with them and that I never had the team members' permission. I then said that it's very impossible and that my team picture proves that. Then Chambers also made the accusations that there were 4 then 5 families that said I did not have permission to take pictures and that I was asked not to take pictures. I told Chambers that was not true. I then asked him to reveal to me who these people or families were. He refused to do that. He never once produced any confirmable proof that these complaints were real. All this time, and even before the police arrived, the Witch Web was standing there watching everything. Every time Chambers went up the stairs to pretend to confirm his accusations by claiming to be speaking to the unidentified complainants, Teehee Witch would follow Chambers up the stairs and then return with him. I asked Chambers why it was that he would not bring the occursors for me to hear and see them. Why was I not allowed to see them or speak with them? Because they did not exist. It is not like I was a danger to them. I am severely disabled and in a wheelchair. Then consider this. Why would members of the teams who lived all over different parts of Canada be worried about me? Have you ever heard of a time ever where when there is a public complaint that the public that was complaining was never seen or heard by anyone? Meanwhile, I could see in the good officer facial expression that he knew that everything Chambers said was not true. He just continued to watch the whole event and said nothing. So for the good officer's understanding, I said that I am being accused here because I am a published political activist that is very well known worldwide. Chambers then said, "Well, you see, that is what happens when you are an activist." The good officer was shocked at Chambers' response, and the good officer then comprehended why I am being harassed. Chamber then went in the office for the Sportsplex that was to my right rear side. He went in with Bob Quigley and then came back out and said to me that he had a piece of paper for me to sign that acknowledged that I was now banned for a period of time from entering the Sportplex property under the Protection of Property Act. I then advised them that that would prevent me from seeking the medical help I had been receiving at Maritime Physiotherapy twice a week for the past year. Chambers then repeated that it does not matter. I was banned. So after signing the document, I read the line that said for a period. But it did not indicate what period of time. So Chambers looks at Bob Quigley, and Quigley was terrified and very nervous. He then said forever and looked at Chambers for confirmation, which Chambers nods yes. So the word forever was had written in, and then Chambers says that it matters not and that they did not have to give me a written statement, that the Sportplex could ban me without the signed document. I was told that Quigley, being the manager, could ban me. I then said he is not the manager and that Max Chauvin, general manager, 902-464-2600 extension 304, was the manager who was on holidays until March 3rd. As I rode past Quigley in my wheelchair, I said to him, I hope you can't live with your conscience because I never did anything wrong. So I went home. Now begins my fruitless attempt at redemption and justice. I spoke with many different people. I had to also wait for Max to return from his holidays so I could speak with him, which I did, and he made it very clear that he did not give a damn about me, my rights, or my thoughts. He truly enjoyed expressing his hatred for me when he told me I was to stay banned. His attitude really surprised me, as he and I had had many pleasant conversations over the past year about my suggestions to making improvements to the wheelchair accessibility issues at the Sportsplex. He knew that I have been attending Maritime Physiotherapy twice a week for the past year and a half and that I never had any problems when I was on the property. I asked him why is it that I was not just banned while the Canada Games were there. He said he did not care and I was staying banned. So I said to him it is a shame that the world has to have people like him in it that have no conscience. My next step was to go to the police station to file a complaint and to get a copy of the police report through my application of release of information. I was told it would take 2 days to get the information. Then a few days later I get a phone call from the police telling me that they would have to blot out the names of the supposed complainants. I was told that the privacy laws would not permit them to tell who they were. I was told they could give me the blotted out report or that the police could send out a request to the complainants giving them 15 days to respond as to whether or not they were willing to reveal their identities to me. There's no justice in Nova Scotia. All there is oppressive, tyrannical officials who engage in covert activities to harm individuals anytime they want because they care nothing about democratic rule of law. This situation has developed because there are no checks and balances here. Another possible reason for this police oppression may be because of my photographing and reporting to the local corporate media on the event on the waterfront when I witnessed the drowning and the very suspicious behavior of the police. You can read my report and see the pictures of this event article Man Drowns at Halifax Buskers updated. Please take note that the attempt on my life was made after I went public about what I witnessed. Secrecy is destroying democracy. Secret organizations kill individuals. Secret societies are anti-democratic. Secrecy lurks in the minds of the criminally insane who are well-dressed, live in good neighborhoods, have the best standard of living, and are protected by secrecy amongst the ranks. Wow! They love the secrecy. They do not have to live up to any true standard of justice. They only have to destroy anyone who is trying to shine the light of truth onto this evil force that now wears only offensive black uniforms of tyrants. They now have way too much money to do whatever they want. They demand these funds from the people and will not disclose what they do with the money, such as buying new police vehicles, and then soon after they end up in private hands of the inner circle of conspirators. Did you know that the police cars drive around with no automobile liability insurance? Yes, beware that if a police car hits you, you cannot file a claim against their insurance because they have none. The police have officially been put above the law. Remember that laws are supposed to be created for the people, and by the people of the society they live in. But today all our governments have become corporations, which are just sophisticated crime syndicates. Secrecy has killed democracy, and now they can freely, covertly kill you in Maine anytime. Be afraid, be very afraid, because this is all very real. The police are now just street thugs wearing their suits of authority. But the ones we have to really worry about are those that work wearing everyday clothes and follow the official modus operandi, that anything they do needs to appear like an everyday common event or crime, so that after they have done their evil, the uniformed officers come along and take care of any loose ends by doing the standard necessary paperwork to cover it all up. End. Thank you for listening, and please go to my Donnie L. Tozzi WordPress blog to see this article with all the included pictures.